Yo, what is up, guys? I hope you guys are having a blessed day today. We're gonna be going over the final picks for UFC 298. We're gonna be starting with the early prelims. We're gonna be moving over to the main card then, the pay-per-view. If you guys are new here, make sure you guys hit the like down below, subscribe to the channel, and make sure you guys leave a comment down below for the YouTube algorithm. And now, finally, let's get into it. We have some drama today. We have some drama unfolding on this card. So, unfortunately, Junior Toph is gonna be fighting De Lima. So Justin Toffa is not fighting De Lima anymore. He had an injury. I don't know what's really going on. Did not know about the injury before. Like, it's really really weird, but unfortunately, so we're not gonna see Justin Toffa fight De Lima anymore. It's gonna be Junior Toffa, his brother, taking this fight on like 24 hours notice. Really weird. That's probably gonna I was definitely picking Toffa there, Justin Toffa. But this is a whole different matchup now. I mean, Junior Toffa has taken this on less than 24 hours notice. But what does help him is the fact that he was already in a training camp, preparing for another fight that's coming up in March. So he was already in the camp, training camp. That's why he's able to take this fight on short notice, less than 24 hours. But still not ideal circumstances for Junior Toffa here, coming in as a replacement for his older brother. Let's get into it now, guys. Let's start with the early fight. So early fight, we have Miranda Maverick taking on Andrea KGB Lee. I have been picking Miranda Maverick. I just feel like she's gonna outwork Andrea Lee. I think she's just gonna be one step ahead. I don't think her striking is honestly that good. I know Andrea Lee's probably the better striker overall, but I just feel like Mavericks would be able to put the pace on Andrea Lee, go for the takedowns over and over. She's got good cardio, so she can push the pace for 15 minutes easy. So I could definitely see like a late submission too from Miranda Maverick. I know she's got really good submissions. I picked her by a third round submission over Priscilla Cachuera, and she got a third round submission last time. So I'm not ruling out the fact that she can go out there and finish anyone. But I think Andrea Lee is going to hang in there. She's really tough. I think this is a do or die for Andrea Lee. I think she's going to give Miranda Maverick a tough fight out there. This is probably going to be, if Andrea Lee loses this fight, she's probably going to be kicked out of the UFC. She's 36 years old now, till end of her career at this point. But I'm gonna trust Miranda Maverick. I think she's gonna do enough out there. She came in phenomenal shape, so I got Miranda Maverick to win by decision. I think Andrea Lee is gonna give a tough fight, but she's just getting older. I don't think she's all that hungry anymore. Her three losses are tough. I mean, Macy Barber, Viviana Araújo, and Natalia Silva. So those are all ranked fighters that she's lost to. But she's still losing these fights. I mean, it's not she's going out there winning these fights or winning at least one of them. I mean, she's still on a 3-5 win losing streak, whether that's to good fighters or not. But still, I'm gonna go with Miranda Maverick, likely by decision. And though I liked over 2.5, I already got over 2.5 rounds in a parlay. But yeah, let's go to the next one, guys. We got our Val Woodburn taking on Oben Elliott. Val Woodburn came in phenomenal shape, man. He looked absolutely ripped. I think this is a must-win fight for Val Woodburn, but I think he's gonna be too stuck in the mud. I think he's gonna be way too slow, one step behind Oben Elliott. So I'm gonna go with the Oben Elliott here, not putting any money on this fight. I mean, they both came in phenomenal shape. I mean, Woodburn's absolutely ripped. This dude is like stocky, really stocky, not the tallest guy for the weight class. He definitely can crack, man. Woodburn can definitely crack, but he's gonna have to connect before he hurts Elliott. Elliott, I mean, we've seen Elliott get hurt almost every single fight. He's hurt against Kai Cabrito, but Kai Cabrito is a very long and rangy striker on the NMA Contender Series, his last fight. I think that he can stay on the outside, pick apart, just poke at Val Woodburn with the striking, with the speed advantage that he's going to have in this fight, mixing the takedowns. He's got really good body kicks. So I do like Tim Elliott. I mean, not Tim Elliott. I like Oben Elliott. I mean, I can't believe I just called him Tim Elliott. That's freaking funny. But I'm gonna go with the Oben Elliott here to get it done by decision, and but not betting yet. We don't know too much about both these guys. I mean, Val Woodburn came in on against Bo Nickel on a pay-per-view card opener, on a, like a 20 like couple days notice. I think it was like a less than a day's notice, and that was a tough fight for Woodburn. But we're gonna learn a lot about both these guys here. Oben Elliott coming in at 3-1 favorite in this fight, so. I'm not gonna touch that line at all. I'm not touching the overs and unders. We could definitely see a finish here. If you guys do like the underdog, I think he probably has a chance to get in top position, maybe rain some ground and pound, get a finish maybe. But I'm gonna go with the more experienced guy, the more proven guy. I think Oben Elliott is more proven, to be honest. But Yeah, I'm gonna go with the Oben Elliott, likely by decision. I hope we see a quick finish here. I want to see some excitement here. I'm picking a lot of decisions on this card, but I feel like this is a fight that could go the distance. I think Woodburn can stay hang in there, be tough the whole time, and maybe lose a close decision. I think Oben Elliott will be able to dominate, win round after round, maybe find a late finish by maybe submission or knockout ground and pound. He does have some nasty ground and pound. But I'm not touching this fight from betting perspective. The line is way too wide. If I got Elliott at like -150, -170, I would have bet him. I would have put him in parlay, but at minus like 300, just not really much meat left on the bones at that point. All right, let's go to the next fight now, guys. We got Danny Barlow taking on Josh Quinlan. Now, this is a fight that I am betting on. I am confident that Danny Barlow is going to find a kill shot in this fight, knock out Josh Quinlan. Now, I actually like Josh Quinlan. He seems like a pretty chill dude. I think Danny Barlow is going to put those hands on him. He's going to show him God with the left hand to God. Danny Barlow, left hand to God. I mean, that's his name for a reason. His name is left hand to God for a reason. He's going to send Josh Quinlan to the gods, and I think Josh Quinlan is going to be in heaven. He's going to wake up after like 10 minutes. So I got Danny Barlow here. He came in pretty good shape. Both these guys came right on the on at right on the scales. Came in right on weight, no problems on the scales at all. I'm gonna go with Barlow by TKO, and he's the first bet that I have on this card. I got him parlayed up, and I also have a KO prop +160 for Danny Barlow, half a unit shot on Danny Barlow by KO, and I actually like that play on Danny Barlow, to be honest. All right, let's move to the next fight now, guys. Next matchup is gonna be Brenson Ribeiro taking on Jiang Min Yang. Now this is a fight that I'm definitely not confident in, because both these guys are very powerful guys. They both can definitely crack. Brenson Ribeiro looked like an absolute brick house on the scales. So I'm not too sure who's gonna win this matchup. I mean, this is gonna be a tough fight for both these guys. I mean, both someone's gonna go to sleep for sure. I was thinking about betting the fight ends in round one by TKO, but I haven't pulled the trigger yet. I don't know if I will pull the trigger on this fight. We still don't know. We still don't know too much about these guys. I'm not putting either one of these guys in parlays, because this is a very crazy fight. I think we're gonna see a finish here either way. I just feel like Jang is more technical on the feet. He's gonna be better technically, but he's got his chin is pretty solid too. I know he's been knocked out. Both these guys have been knocked out in the past, but I feel like Jang can hang in there. Jang probably has a better cardio overall. I haven't really seen Brenson Ribeiro's cardio. But Brenson Ribeiro has fought the better level competition, so I cannot really blame anyone for taking Brenson Ribeiro here as a plus money dog. Honestly, not a bad look. But if Brenson Ribeiro gets it done, likely gonna be by like knockout around one knockout is like +400. I was thinking about like maybe sprinkling round one KO for Brenson Ribeiro, and then maybe round one KO from Jang. But I'm just gonna leave it alone. We don't know too much about these guys. And yeah, even under 1.5 is like -300. There's not really much meat left on the bones at this point. We're just gonna watch this fight as a fan and see how these guys do out there. They're both making their UFC debut here. Jang is coming off road to the UFC, where he got a big upset win over there over Tokos. Brenson Ribeiro got a pretty big upset win on Dana White Contender Series in the main event over Bruno Lopez. So there's gonna be a lot on the line for this fight, and I'm gonna take Jang here, Jang to win by knockout round one. But I could definitely see Jang getting knocked out here, because Brenson Ribeiro's got an 81-inch reach, and he's an absolute pit bull. So either fight's gonna end in the first round by knockout, either way. Let's go to the next one, guys. We got Rene Nakamura taking on Carlos Vera, and yeah, I think Carlos Nakamura is gonna smoke him. Nakamura's already praying for him, and I think he's gonna smoke him. I mean, the odds are like just way too wide for this fight. There's not What are you gonna do with the odds? I got a parlay with the over 2.5 rounds in Maverick and Lee, and over 2.5 rounds in Matt Mirab and Henry with Nakamura money line at -800. So I got that parlay, but I don't know. Like, I'm not really putting more money on that, because there's not really you're not really gonna make much on -800. But I think Nakamura is an absolute lock. He came in phenomenal shape for this fight. I mean, Carlos Vera came in pretty good shape for a 36-year-old, the guy making his UFC debut right now. So I mean, we're supposed to see Carlos Vera fight Daniel Marcos a couple of times. We were supposed to see him fight Victor Hugo Silva. Both those fights were canceled because I think Marcos had a visa issue or something. Then I don't know what happened with the Victor Hugo Silva fight. So he's been preparing to make his UFC debut for a while now. So, but I think Nakamura is going to be a big problem for him. I think Nakamura is going to knock him out in the first two rounds. So I got Nakamura by TKO in the first two rounds. I hope. I just hope that Carlos Vera doesn't get brutally put out cold. Like it's going to be nasty knockout. I think from Nakamura here. So Nakamura can definitely mix in the takedowns too. And inside the distance for Nakamura -175. Honestly, not a bad look. I could see a finish here. I could definitely see a finish here in this fight. So Nakamura by round one KO. I don't know what that number is, but I'm just gonna leave the props alone, to be honest, because Nakamura doesn't really rush to finish guys. I mean, Fernie Garcia is way tougher, to be fair. So I know he couldn't really finish Fernie Garcia out there, but he dominated Fernie Garcia, and he was looking for submissions on the ground when he had Fernie Garcia on the ground. So either way, yeah, I think this is going to be a decent fight here, and I'm going to take Nakamura by TKO in the first two rounds. All right, so we got the short notice of placement here. We got Junior Tafa's brother, coming in off. I know he's not really coming off the couch because he was preparing for a fight coming up in March. So he was already in the training camp. I'm sure he already knew that his brother was injured. Justin Tafa was injured during the camp. So I'm just like, it's weird that they just told the UFC about him, Justin Tafa, being injured right now, like 24 hours before the fight. So as much as I wanted to pick the Tafa, like I'm a big Tafa brother fan. So, but I can't really trust him to go out there on 24 hours notice. And I don't think his takedown defense is going to be solid enough to defend the takedowns. And then De Lima trains out of American Top Team, so I think De Lima is going to be more than prepared for a style like Junior Tafa. I think Justin Tafa had better takedown than Junior Tafa, to be honest. So, but Junior Tafa is going to be way quicker with the punches, way faster, way younger. So there's a lot of factors that are playing into Junior Tafa's game here. But I can't really pick a guy taking this fight on 24 hours notice. So I'm gonna have to pick De Lima here. I was picking Justin Tafa, but man, it's a tough one. But I could definitely see De Lima losing this fight because he's 40 years old now. But you can be 40 at heavyweight. It doesn't make much of a difference. But Junior Tafa can definitely, maybe he's still young, man. He's not even like barely in his prime right now. So maybe he goes out there, looks like his takedown defense holds up. He fought Parker Porter last time too. I think I bet on him against Parker Porter. And Parker Porter isn't really known for his grappling, doesn't really have any durability. Long live the GOAT Parker Porter. But yeah, I'm gonna go with the De Lima here. I think De Lima's gonna get this done. De Lima made weight, I mean, came in at 261, I think at 262. And I think De Lima's gonna be more than prepared for a style like Junior Tafa. I think he's gonna mix it in pretty well, land those leg kicks. But I could definitely see Junior Tafa sniping him. So I'm not touching this fight betting wise. I took a stab on Justin Tafa at +145 early on the week, but now like that he's fighting his brother, I mean, stepping in 24 hours notice, I can't really pick him to win here. So I'm gonna go with De Lima here. I think De Lima's gonna get this done, likely by submission. I'll say a submission on the ground by De Lima. That's the pick. They got the pictures all mixed and messed up here. We got Nakamura here. I mean, the pictures are not in order, but there's Rinne Nakamura. Rinne Nakamura is going to smoke Carlos Vera. And we got Mackenzie Dernst. He was the last one to weigh in other than Junior Tafa. Junior Tafa, like, just fun. He was going through the process of getting into this fight. So Mackenzie Dernst looks like he had a tough weight cut. And but she made weight. I mean, she looked pretty good on the scales. Normally, she looks pretty good always. I mean, like, she's a good-looking girl. But I think Lemos going to smoke her. I got Lemos by TKO round two. And I'm just betting the money line. I put a 1.25 units on Lemos money line, -125. So I would have liked to get plus money. I mean, Lemos opened up at -250. So I wasn't really gonna touch Lemos anything over -150. But when you're giving me a power puncher against a girl that doesn't really have the best takedowns, I mean, she's Mackenzie Dern is a world class jiu-jitsu artist. So she's got really good grappling. Some of the best. She's one of the most dangerous submission grapplers at this weight class for women's MMA. And if she gets the fight to the ground, I could definitely see her locking in a submission. But I can't really trust her to get the takedowns. I mean, she doesn't have the best takedowns out there. She normally barely even gets one single takedown in her fights. I mean, I know she got a bunch of takedowns over Angela Hill, but Angela Hill was getting rocked all over the place. Angela Hill just looked off in that fight. And yeah, she looked horrible in that Andrade fight. Maybe she goes out there, looks better. But I mean, Lemos was preparing for, she was preparing for Tatiana Suarez. I think she's gonna be more than prepared for Mackenzie Dern's takedowns in this fight. I mean, Tatiana Suarez is a monster wrestler for women's MMA and monster grappler. I don't think Lemos is gonna be too worried about Dern shooting from like a mile away. So I got Lemos by TKO second round. I'm a big fan of Mackenzie Dern though. I mean, we all are. I'm sure you guys are big fans of Mackenzie Dern. We obviously don't want to see her get knocked out back to back. What I think is gonna happen, I'm pretty confident Lemos to get this done by TKO second round. I think she's gonna smoke, like hurt her a couple of times in the first round. Then I think the referee's gonna step in because she's just gonna be getting cracked back and over and over. But the thing that worries me about Lemos is her cardio is kind of suspect though. So we're gonna have to watch out for the cardio for Lemos. But I just don't think that Dern is gonna put the pace on Amanda Lemos to like really tire her out throughout the fight. So I got Lemos by TKO second round. That's the pick. Why is John Anik's picture here? That's really freaking weird. All right, we got Roman Kopylov next versus Fluffy Hernandez. Pay-per-view time, guys. Make sure you guys hit the sub down below. Make sure you guys hit the like down below, and make sure you guys leave a comment down below for the YouTube algorithm. I appreciate all the support, guys. As always, let's move on over to the main card now. We got Roman Kopylov taking on Fluffy Hernandez. I mean, at first I wanted to pick Fluffy Hernandez, but I feel like Roman Kopylov is, if he's fixed a hole in his grappling, like he had a hole when he came into UFC. Guys were taking him down. Carl Robertson took him down, submitted him. And then Albert Drive took him down, like, well, was able to hold him down for a majority of the fight. But I feel like he's been working on that part of his game, man. He knows that he needs to sharpen up that part of his game if he wants to be a champion at in the UFC. And he's gone to Dagestan to train his wrestling. But Fluffy Hernandez is a way better fighter. There's a reason that he's coming into this fight as a -250. But I'm gonna roll the dice here. I'm gonna go with Roman Kopylov here to get it done by knockout. I feel like he's gonna be landing those body kicks over and over, but he's gonna have to defend some takedowns because Fluffy Hernandez is a very durable guy, very tough guy. It's not gonna be easy to get him out of there. But I could see Kopylov defending the takedowns, getting more confidence by every minute that passes by. So I'm gonna go with Roman Kopylov by TKO. Second on TKO from Roman Kopylov. He's sitting at +210 right now. So honestly, like, I took a shot on him for a single unit at +150. I mean, I'm thinking about maybe putting another like half unit on him at +210, but I don't know. I haven't really decided that if I want to put more money on Kopylov because Fluffy Hernandez is no joke. I mean, Fluffy Hernandez is preparing for Ikram Aliyev, so it's gonna be a tough fight, I think, for Kopylov though. I was pretty confident in Ikram Aliyev, but Kopylov taking this fight on short notice, so just a little bit worried about his cardio. I'm worried about his cardio, but if Fluffy Hernandez puts the pace on him, he can definitely just drown him throughout the fight and submit him later in the fight. Fluffy Hernandez has really good anaconda chokes, Darce chokes, I mean, arm triangle. Like, he's got a lot of tools on the ground, so Kopylov's gonna have to fend out the takedowns. And if he keeps it on the feet, I think Kopylov's got a chance to get it done. Maybe he could win a decision too. I wouldn't really advise anyone to go bet his KO prop. Why not just bet his money line? I mean, his money line sitting at +210. If you like Kopylov, just take the money line. Much better value, much safer. So I like Kopylov by money line, +210. That's the pick. All right, guys. Next up, we got so Henry Cejudo taking on Merab, the Machine, Duwalis Willie. We got the King of Cringe taking on the Machine, Duwalis Willie. And both these guys came pretty good on the scales. I mean, they looked pretty good on the scales. I mean, Merab looked, he was ready to go, man. Merab's bringing that intensity to the weigh-in, so I actually like Merab here. He's my lock of the week. I'm pretty confident that he's gonna get this done by decision. I don't think he's finishing Henry Cejudo. I know he's been talking about it. He wants to knock out Henry Cejudo, but I don't think he's gonna finish Cejudo, man. Cejudo's a very, very high-level fight IQ guy, so I think Cejudo's gonna be able to. He's gonna be defending takedowns for a majority of the fight. I think Merab's gonna put the pace on him. I would be way more confident than if this was a 5-round fight, because I don't think that Cejudo would ever be able to keep up a pace for 5-round fights for Merab. But this is a 3-round fight, so Cejudo obviously has a chance to get it done if he throws like a flying knee or something, because he's very unorthodox when he throws his striking. But I'm pretty confident Merab's gonna get this done. I think this is Merab time right now. Cejudo's 37 years old now. and he's been talking about retirement for the last couple of years, and he's got a family that he's taking care of. I think Marab's way more hungry. Marab's out there running mountains like every morning, so I got Marab by decision. I like the over 2.5 rounds in a parlay, and I like Marab moneyline a lot. He's my lock of the week here. I think he's gonna get it done by total domination, 30-27 for Marab Dwoswali, the machine. All right, guys, let's go to Marab had some intensity at the scales, man. Holy shit. Look at this dude, man. Holy shit. You don't want to be fighting this dude when he's super hungry. Marab is a hungry, hungry dude. He's a hungry, hungry man. Holy shit. How many pictures they got of Marab? Holy shit. Look at this dude. That's freaking funny. All right, guys. Next up, we got Ian Gary taking on Jeff Hands of Steel Neo. We got Ian Cut Gary taking on Jeff Hands of Steel Neo. Let's see who gets it done. Gary's going to get this done. I'm not as confident as other people on Gary. My confidence has rained down throughout the week. I mean, like, I was way more confident in him when they made this fight. I put him in a parlay with Cortez Acosta. Cortez Acosta already got the win over Arlovski. That was minus 400. And I got Ian Gary like a minus 210, I think, minus 210. And then I put him in a parlay with Sean O'Malley, who's fighting on that 299 card. Gary, like, he's going to have to stay on the outside the whole time. Use his high fight IQ, not start trading in the pocket. I mean, that's what Shavkat was doing out there, trading with Jeff Neal in the pocket. I mean, both these guys look really good on the scales, man. Look at this dude, Ian Gary, man. Ian Gary looked super ripped out there. I think he's been training really hard for this fight, so it's a tough one. This is definitely a tough one. If you guys like Jeff Neal, I would look at the finish only prop for Jeff Neal. If there's anyone that's gonna finish this fight, I don't see Ian Gary putting himself at risk to finish this fight. Ian Gary's the type of guy to stay safe on the outside, just win the fights. He doesn't really care about finish all that much. I think he's going to be worried about the power coming back his way from Jeff Neal. I think he's just going to stay on the outside, just make this fight, just pop shot Jeff Neal from the outside. But Jeff Neal is really dangerous. If he gets Ian Gary up against the fence, he can definitely knock him out. So I'm not ruling out Jeff Neal knocking out Ian Gary. It could definitely happen. This is why we're so hyped up for this fight, because this is a dangerous dude that Gary's fighting. But I think Gary's going to give him a lot of looks to think about. He's gonna make him think about those jabs, those leg kicks, body kicks. I got Gary by decision. I liked over 2.5 rounds. I played over 2.5 already, minus 135. It was down all the way at plus 100 at one point, I mean. But I already took the jump on it early, minus 135, and now it's sitting at minus 140, I think. I liked over 2.5 rounds here. I don't think we're going to see a finish here. If we do see a finish, it's probably going to be from Jeff Neal's side. I got Gary decision, 29-28. It's going to be a close fight, I think. All right, guys. Next up, we got the co-main right now of the evening. We got Paulo Costa taking on Robert Whittaker. Paulo Costa looked like an absolute god on the scales, man. This dude is ripped, and he's a big dude for middleweight. So Paulo Costa is a big dude. He's physical. Obviously not as technical as Robert Whittaker. Robert Whittaker is way more technical than Paulo Costa, but it's gonna be a good fight, man. I'm really hyped to see how this one plays out. I don't have any money on this fight right now. I haven't made any bets on this fight. I was thinking about betting Robert Whittaker decision plus 130, but I just haven't been able to pull the trigger. If Paulo Costa missed weight on the scales, I probably would have pulled the trigger for like a unit and a half maybe on Whittaker decision. But he did not miss weight. He came in right on the scales. Came in on the scales right on weight. He's been looking serious throughout the week. I mean, he's not been joking around too much this week. So maybe Paulo Costa goes out there, finds a kill shot in Robert Whittaker. But I'm going to go with a more technical guy here. I think Robert Whittaker is going to get this done. Likely decision. So I got Robert Whittaker decision. And it's going to be a good fight, man. I really hope we see a finish here from either one of these guys. I really hope if Paulo Costa wins, it's probably going to be like a knockout. I don't think he's going to win a decision over Whittaker. So if you guys do like Paulo Costa by knockout, it's probably going to be the way he's going to get it done. But if you're not knocking out Rockhold at this point in his career, I really can't pick you to win by knockout over Whittaker, who's been staying active. I mean, Robert Whittaker got knocked out by Duplessis, but Duplessis is a champion right now, so no shame there for Robert Whittaker. But I'm going to pick Robert Whittaker by decision. And Robert Whittaker looking phenomenal shape too, man. He looked absolutely ripped. But Paulo Costa is way bigger than him. I mean, he's going to be much bigger than him. I was watching the face-offs last night. And yeah, man, Whitaker's way smaller than Paulo Costa, but I think Whitaker's gonna be able to stay on the outside, land that jabs over and over, land those oblique kicks. I can't freaking say that, but land those oblique side kicks to the knee. I'm just gonna not say that word anymore. But he's gonna be throwing those side kicks to the knee of Paulo Costa. He's gonna be throwing those body kicks, but Paulo Costa. I think Whitaker is gonna have to stay dancing. He's gonna have to stay moving the whole time. He can like get backed up against the fence. That's where Paulo Costa is really dangerous with those body hooks, the way he goes to the body and the right hook up top. So Costa can definitely catch him, man. I mean, we know that Whitaker's chin is a issue, has been an issue throughout his whole career. Whitaker's been dropped with the jab so many times. I can't even remember how many times Whitaker's been dropped with the jab. But I'm gonna trust the more technical guy here. I think Whitaker can bounce back. Yeah, Whitaker by decision is the pick, +130. All right, guys, main event time now. We got Ilia Topuria taking on Robert Whitaker, not Robert Whitaker, Alexander Volkanovski. And yeah, I'm really hyped to see how this one plays out, man. I think it's gonna be a really good matchup here, guys. And at first, like when I heard about this matchup, I mean, I was picking Topuria. Like, I was like, Topuria's gonna smoke him, this and that. But after doing tape study and like thinking about this fight a little bit, like throughout the months, I changed my mind. I'm picking Volkanovski here. Topuria looked phenomenal shape, man. I think Volkanovski had a tougher weight cut than Topuria. Topuria didn't look too sucked in on the scales. I mean, he said that he drinks like a half a liter of wine before the weigh-in, so not the weigh-ins, I mean before the weight cut. So that, I think that helps him cut the weight a little bit. Looks like it's working for him. I mean, he did not look drained on the scales at all. But yeah, I'm not really. I already put a bet on Topuria like a couple months back. Got a pretty good decent number on it, but I've been thinking about cashing out, but I'm just probably just gonna let it ride, see what happens. But I feel like Volkanovski can get this done. I'm probably gonna cash out with the bet, to be honest, because I think Volkanovski can get this done, man. Volkanovski looks super hungry right now, and he's coming off the knockout loss. I think he wants to prove everyone wrong that's calling him too old, this and that. I don't think this is gonna be a Jose Aldo versus Conor McGregor situation here. But maybe we could have a new champion tomorrow, man. We're gonna find out tomorrow, I guess. Really good matchup here, man. This is gonna be one of the best 145 fights out there ever in UFC history, I think. But I'm gonna go with the end still champion, Alexander Volkanovski. I think he's gonna run this weight class for a bit. But I could definitely be wrong, man. This is an even fight on the odds for a reason. This fight could go definitely either way. And Topuria looked really good on the scales, man. He's been very confident throughout the week, so. Maybe he goes out there and Volkanovski just looks too slow now. Maybe somehow, maybe he's too hesitant to throw those power shots now, cause he got caught with the head kick. He knows there's a switch there. But I'm gonna go with the guy that's been proven at this weight class, that's gone 5 rounds so many times. That's fought Makhachev on 10 days' notice. I mean, I know he got knocked out, but still, this dude's not scared to fight anyone on the planet. So, not saying that Topuria is scared or anything, but. It's gonna be a tough fight, man. I think it's gonna be a really good fight. I think we're gonna be the ones that's really gonna have fun watching this fight as fans. So I got Anstel Volkanovski to win and defend his belt by decision. I don't think he's finishing Topuria. I think Topuria's gas tank is very solid too. He's got some of the best boxing out there. So I got Volkanovski. I think the experience can help him. And he's gonna be throwing more volume overall, I think. And I don't think he's gonna stay in the pocket too much. He's been talking about how he's not gonna be punching back for Topuria. Normally, Topuria hits these guys when they stay too much in the pocket. But so I got Volkanovski and still. Make sure you guys hit the like down below, guys. If you guys enjoyed the breakdown, the weigh-in final picks for weigh-in after weigh-in. So make sure you guys subscribe to the channel, guys. We're trying to work our way to 1,500 subscribers now. We just passed 1K. I appreciate you guys all, man. As always, I'm gonna go take a nap, man. I've been up since like 4 o'clock in the morning, and we were live throughout like all morning for that Octagon promotion. So I'll probably be live later tonight. So make sure you guys come hang out with me later, and I'll see you guys the next one, man. Good luck on all your bets. I hope you guys cash all your bets tomorrow, and I'll see you guys in the next one later.